you as well for the wonderful conversation. Everything is quite perfect. So I will speak today, my talk will be a bit different maybe from what was established yesterday, but not in contradiction with what was established yesterday, because I will defend a Freudian conception of the unconscious today, which is not the same as Merleau-Ponty-inspired conception of the unconscious we got to be familiar with yesterday, but they are not incompatible either. There is a way of understanding their connection as well, and maybe we can talk about it during the discussion. So the aim of this talk is to answer the difficult question indicated in the title: can an emotion be unconscious? So is it possible for an emotion to be an actually lived experience and at the same time remain unknown to the subject? Or maybe in clearer terms, how can I have a feeling without actually feeling it? At first sight, it seems impossible to imagine the existence of unconscious emotions or feelings. Now, just a small word on the difference between these two concepts. Of course, it is possible to consider a difference between the concept of emotion and the concept of feeling. There's a difference which I would call the difference of nuance rather than the difference of phenomenon described by these two concepts. Because the term emotion indicates something like an internal affective movement, as in the expression, for instance, I am moved by your gesture, and this sort of movement can be very complex, it can be very determined as well, it can belong to many categories, like fear, anger, etc. So it seems to be something very complex and something that is closer to conscience than feelings, because the term feeling puts the accent on the bodily dimension and invites to a comparison with physical sensations. However, both terms describe from different points of view the same type of experience, which is a process, which is a dynamic experience. And of course, this point could be explored further, but in this talk, I will use the two terms as synonyms. So, if unlike ideas or other experiences, like volitive experiences, the essence of an emotion does not lie in the content, but in the way it is experienced, in the way it feels like, then unconscious emotions seem at first sight impossible or even contradictory. However, this statement creates a problem if we place ourselves in the point of view of the psychoanalytical theory of the unconscious before it advanced in these words. This is because most of the unconscious processes revealed in the course of an analysis have strong emotional connotations. This emotional aspect of the unconscious processes is indeed the main reason of their repression. In an absolutely neutral thought, would not need to be repressed. If we deny the possibility for an emotion to be unconscious, then how can we account for all the unconscious desires, for instance, that Freud managed to bring to light using his analytical method? So how can we account for all the cases of the clinic of psychoanalysis? So in order to solve this puzzle, we will need to change our traditional descriptive point of view that uses introspective reflection in order to seize and describe mental phenomena. This point of view is unable to give us an account not only of unconscious emotions, but of any unconscious event, since describing such an event would mean that it becomes instantly conscious. Introspection or reflection denies us the access to the unconscious aspects of the experience, which are precisely the aspects we wanted to describe in the first place. It is thus by principle that in order to understand the unconscious, we need to switch to a dynamic point of view that includes the causal inference of unconscious processes from their conscious effects or symptoms. However, even in this dynamic perspective, it is a challenge to prove that an emotion can be actually lived without our knowledge, that we can feel pain, sadness, anger, or joy, and yet have no notion of it. In order to understand better what an unconscious emotion could mean, and whether there is a way to conceive it without contradiction, I will use two authors who defend the dynamic theory of the unconscious, combined with a thorough attention given to the question of emotions. One of them is, of course, Sigmund Freud, but the other, far less known today, is German philosopher Theodor Lips. I'll first explain Lips' understanding of the unconscious, its role in the mental life, and its relation to emotions and affectivity. Knowing that Lips was a major reference for Freud, almost one of the very few explicit philosophical references that appear in Freud's works, I will then show what elements of Lips' theory of the unconscious Freud explicitly adopted. And finally, I will show why the idea of unconscious emotions, which is incompatible with Lips' theory of the unconscious, becomes possible in Freud's more radical conception. So here's my first section, Theodor Lips' theory of the unconscious and the impossibility of unconscious emotions. And since Theodor Lips is very little studied today, I will give a few biographical pointers, and I will describe briefly his psychology. So, despite being one of the important philosophers of his time, Theodor Lips' dynamic psychology of the unconscious is not very well known today. We can find Lips' name occasionally mentioned in several fields of philosophical research. He is indeed mentioned in Husserl's Prolegomena as one of the main representative figures of psychologism, a position very much criticized at the time. He is also one of the main theorists of the concept of Einfühlung, which was used by Husserl in his fifth Cartesian meditation in order to explain intersubjectivity. But of course, the theory of Einfühlung was mainly an aesthetics theory concerning the way a work of art can create its emotional effect on the viewer. And this is why Lips became a fairly important reference in this field. His concept of Einfühlung was also used more recently in neuroscience in order to provide a philosophical back frame of the theory of mirror neurons. And finally, and this is what interests me here, Lips' work is important for the historians of psychoanalysis, since Lips is one of the very few philosophers mentioned repeatedly and positively by Freud in his works and in the letters he wrote to his friend Wilhelm Fries in the 1890s. And it is striking to see that Lips stayed a reference for Freud. It wasn't just an initial reference. His name is mentioned in the seventh chapter of the Interpretation of Dreams, but it is also appears in 1938, so at the end of Freud's career, in a note to the Psychoanalyse. And in another study that was published that year. So it stayed a reference up till the end of Freud's work. And I would like also to mention that Freud possessed almost all Lips' works in his library. So he was really familiar. Lips was really an influence to Freud in a strong sense of the word. So here are some biographical pointers. So Lips was formed in Wilhelm Wundt's Institute of Experimental Psychology in Leipzig. He later on became professor of aesthetics and psychology in Breslau and finished his career in Munich, where he studied he succeeded to Brentano's student Karl Stumpf. His philosophical project stood on the belief that the foundation of human culture and science is to be found in psychology. His realm of psychology was, however, a very particular one, because unlike Wundt's experimental psychology, Lips was not interested in finding correlation between the mind and the body. He believed, in fact, that the psychophysiological research of his time was using metaphysical assumptions that couldn't be verified, and he endorsed in return a pure psychology that would not respect the limits of the mental realm. However, this psychology was not of the same nature as Brentano's descriptive psychology. It was contemporary as well, a very important school of psychology at the time. While Brentano and his students believed, as Lipps did, that psychology should study exclusively and exhaustively the sphere of mental phenomena, it was their belief that these phenomena were all accessible to inner consciousness. The mark of a mental phenomenon was indeed for Brentano the fact that it was conscious. Thus, Brentano's descriptive psychology is necessarily a psychology of consciousness. All mental phenomena are also conscious phenomena. Lipps did not agree on this last point. The psychology he defended was a psychology of the unconscious rather than a psychology of consciousness. This was the main thesis of his 1883 book, Basic Facts of the Mental Life, and also of the famous conference, The Concept of the Unconscious in Psychology, a conference he pronounced at the closure of the Third International Congress of Psychology that took place in Munich in 1896, which resumed the main ideas of the book. And I say the famous conference because it's mostly the only text that psychoanalysts read in order to understand the relation between Lipps and Freud. So this is maybe the most known, well-known text of Theodor Lipps today. So while Lipps, like Brentano, defended a pure psychology which treated of the psychological phenomena without considering their physiological causes, Lipps's pure psychology differed from Brentano's pure psychology in two crucial aspects. It did not have the same object. Brentano thought that the object of psychology should be the conscious phenomena, while Lipps considered that the question of the unconscious is the main question of psychology. And in consequence, it did not have the same method either. Brentano's psychology was descriptive, while Lipps's psychology was dynamic and genetic. It was clear to Lipps that a descriptive method could not see the unconscious aspects of the mental life. But it was also obvious to him that only a very few mental phenomena were actually conscious. A vast number of processes, including the acts through which a content became conscious, stayed themselves unconscious. The whole dynamic aspect of the mental life was inaccessible to consciousness as such. We can be conscious of an idea, of the content of an idea, but we cannot be conscious of the act that presents this idea. Consciousness of this act, through reflection, transforms the act as a dynamic phenomenon into a new idea, losing thus the dynamic aspects of the act. So the dynamic stays inaccessible to reflection. On the other hand, all the contents of consciousness that are not presently thought, all the past ideas, judgments, emotions, are not simply erased from the mind, but continue to exercise a certain influence on the consciousness of the subject. In his conference, The Concept of the Unconscious in Psychology, Lipps uses a very interesting example. We can hear a phrase, and as soon as its content becomes conscious, it is accompanied by a feeling of rejection. The reasons of this rejection might be extremely complex, and they might include past experiences related or not to the content of the phrase, moral thoughts about what is right and wrong, beautiful or ugly, or about who we are and who we would like to be. Even though the feeling of rejection is present and conscious, its complex reasons are not explicitly formulated and don't appear in any way to consciousness at the moment the phrase is understood. So they say implicit, this is something that resembles a lot to the sense of the unconscious we talked about yesterday. So all these reasons, they can, of course, be brought to consciousness later on by an analysis of the negative reaction, but at the present moment, at the moment of the reaction, they stay unconscious. This example proves in Lipps's view that there are such phenomena that have the same structure as conscious mental phenomena, but stay unconscious. They are not actually present to a conscious level. They have, however, a certain form of presence. It's a conscious phenomena, and the proof of this presence is that they have conscious effects, namely the feeling of rejection in our example. Lipps uses this example in order to prove that there is no contradiction in stating the existence of an unconscious that is mental or psychic and not simply physical. This unconscious contains phenomena similar to conscious phenomena, but who lack consciousness. Thus, there is no contradiction in stating the existence, for instance, of unconscious ideas or representations. They are unconscious because they are not effectively conscious at the present moment, but they can be described as ideas or presentations because they are potentially conscious, either because they were already once conscious in the past, or because they are actually in the process of becoming conscious at the present moment. Thus, an unconscious mental phenomenon is in Lipps's view a phenomenon that is potentially conscious. Potentially, but not actually conscious. An unconscious idea, for instance, is a potential idea. Here's a quote. What I have consciously experienced, we must admit, is not entirely lost once it has disappeared from consciousness. And we can hear here the same sort of argument that we can find later on in Freud in order to prove the existence of the unconscious. So what I have consciously experienced is not entirely lost once it has disappeared from consciousness. There is some part of this past experience unknown in its essence that still lives in me. It is the existence of this unknown part that enables the return of the past conscious experience as a conscious experience, or if we prefer, as a conscious analog of this past conscious experience. This part, or mental trait for Gedächtnisspur, this is the German word, contains the possibility of a similar present representation. This mental trace is a representative potentiality or a potential representation. Now, if we transpose the question in the field of emotion, we should conclude that there is such a thing as a potential emotion. However, emotions are characterized not by their object or content, but by the way they feel. It seems hard to imagine that an emotion could be present without being actually felt. So it's hard to imagine what a potentially felt emotion could be. What sort of joy is one I cannot enjoy? If we go back to the example of the feeling of rejection Lipps uses in his conference, it becomes clear that while the reasons for the rejection stay unconscious, the feeling of rejection, which is the effect this unconscious phenomena produce, is precisely a conscious effect. The mental life, in its view, is a whole in which all the processes are related to one another. At each moment, quite a complex net of processes are at work, but only few of them arrive to consciousness. All the others stay unconscious, but still associated in many different ways to the whole. We could say with Lipps that the conscious representation is the final result of a complex unconscious process itself in relation with all the other mental processes that take place at the same time. On the basis of this theory and of the example we analyzed before, we could conclude that for Lipps, feelings function precisely as the indicators of this mess of interconnected unconscious processes. A certain process produces a conscious content, and the relation this content has to the whole of the mental life stays unconscious appears to consciousness in the form of feelings. So feelings are the indicators of the relation between the content that became conscious and all the rest of our mental life that stays at the moment unconscious. So in the example, the feeling of rejection which is conscious is the indicator of all the past experiences that are related to the phrase I am hearing, which is conscious, and that causes in me this rejection. Okay, so we can conclude this section stating that in Lipps's theory, even though they are intimately related to the unconscious, emotions cannot be themselves unconscious. They are, on the contrary, the conscious indicators of an unconscious activity. So I arrive to my second section, which concerns Freud's innovation concerning the unconscious and why this innovation makes way to the possibility of unconscious emotions. So several letters that Freud wrote to Wilhelm Fries in 1898 show that the father of psychoanalysis was reading Lipsitz's Basic Facts of the Mental Life right before the interpretation of dreams was conceived. And in fact, Lipsitz quoted in the chapter 7 of the Interpretation of Dreams as the only philosopher who has supported the idea that all that is psychic or mental is not necessarily also conscious. But no matter how much Freud agreed with Lipsitz's position in the Basic Facts and in his 1896 conference, he still made a point in explaining that even Lipsitz could not imagine the profound psychological dimension called unconscious in Freud's metapsychology. In fact, Lipsitz's point in his 1896 conference was that there is a continuity between the unconscious and the conscious aspects of the mental life. Indeed, Lipsitz thought that any mental content that became conscious is the result of a process which stays in most of its phases unconscious. Not all such processes succeed, and thus some of the mental processes never actually arrive to consciousness. Still, they could have become conscious if other processes didn't demand the attention of the subject with greater force at the same time. There is no essential difference for Lipsitz between the unconscious and the conscious dimensions of the mental life, since all unconscious phenomena are potentially conscious, by definition. Now Freud, on the other hand, has a different idea of the dynamics of the mental life. It is not continuity but fracture that appears to be the main dynamic structure that relates the unconscious to the conscious. This is because Freud does not use the term unconscious in the same way as Lipsitz. What Lipsitz called unconscious corresponds rather to Freud's preconscious, a part of our mental life that is not actually conscious, but could arrive to consciousness without any major obstacle. But Freud has also his own concept of the unconscious, not to be mistaken for the preconscious. Rather, the preconscious and the conscious work together in a coherent system, while the unconscious corresponds to a different system obeying to different rules. If there is a dynamic that relates the two, it is a dynamic of fracture, of attack and defense, for which Freud uses one word, repression. We all know. So here's a quote from the Interpretation of Dreams. So there are two kinds of unconscious which have not yet been distinguished by psychologists. Both of them are unconscious in the sense used by psychology. But in our sense, one of them, which we term the UCS, is also inadmissible to consciousness, while we term the other the PCS, because its excitations, after observing certain rules, are able to reach consciousness. So what characterizes Freud's concept of the repressed unconscious is precisely the fact that it cannot become conscious as such. The repression is resistance that forbids a particular process to reach the preconscious stages that precede the arrival, of a certain content to consciousness, makes any negotiation impossible. So the fracture is not between preconscious and conscious, but between. So Freud's theory is consistent with Lipsitz's theory as far as the preconscious goes. There is continuity between preconscious and conscious mental phenomena, but there is a fracture between the unconscious, the repressed unconscious, and the preconscious in Freud. So the repressed part of the mental life never was and never can become conscious. Freud's concept of the unconscious is thus much more radical than the psychological concept used by Lipsitz. It names a part of the mental life that is inaccessible to any kind of knowledge. Of course, it is then vital to show how we can even imagine the existence of such a profoundly mysterious unconscious. Well, Freud's answer is similar to the one provided by Lipps. We know about the existence of this part of our mental life because it has visible effects on our conscious life. These effects are dreams, Freudian sleeps, and neurotic symptoms that can only be explained satisfyingly by introducing the hypothesis of a repressed unconscious. Now, proving that such a repressed unconscious exists, and it is the best way to explain neurotic symptoms, etc., is the main metapsychological test for psychoanalysis. And I will not go through all the arguments Freud could master through his entire career in order to defend his discovery against philosophers, against scientists, and even against the public opinion. But I would rather get back to my original question that concerns unconscious emotions and feelings. It appears, in fact, that Freud's repressed unconscious is made mostly of affective elements. In the interpretation of dreams, he defines all dreams, for instance, as accomplishments of unconscious desires. So this definition assumes thus clearly the existence of such unconscious desires. The neurotic symptoms are also explained in terms of desire, and the vast number of cases that Freud described in his work show that it is not uncommon for anger or love to be unconscious, to stay unknown to the subject. But how can we give a theoretical explanation of the existence of such feelings that are not actually felt, of which the subject is not aware? So we have the examples, but we don't know how to explain them. We have the facts, but we have no means to understand them so far. Freud himself asks the question in an important metapsychological text from 1915, titled The Unconscious. A short section of this text is dedicated to the question whether, besides unconscious ideas, we can also consider the possibility of unconscious emotions. The term emotion encompasses for Freud two categories of experiences. Instinctual impulses or drives on the one hand, emotions and feelings on the other. In the case of instincts, Freud's position is clear. An instinct, I quote, an instinct can never become an object of consciousness. Only the idea that represents the instinct can. This is because the only way an instinct manifests itself is through its ideational representative, which can be either an idea or maybe an affective movement, an emotion. In the case of emotions and feelings, the answer is thus more complicated since they seem to play precisely the role of the conscious representatives of a drive. So we have the drive, and then we know we have the drive because we have a feeling. But we know we have to feel the feeling in order to know about the drive. So Freud sees the difficulty we have identified so far in imagining an emotion or a feeling of which we know nothing. Indeed, what we call by these terms is precisely the experience we are able to identify and acknowledge as such. And in Freud's words, the point, quote, it is surely of the essence of an emotion that we should be aware of it, i.e. that it should become known to consciousness, plus the possibility of the attribute of unconsciousness would be completely excluded as far as emotions, feelings, and effects are concerned. And yet, as we have already mentioned, unconscious emotions constitute the main object of psychoanalysis. This point can be understood only in relation to Freud's dynamic point of view and his concept of repression. Because, for Freud, to suppress the development of an effect is the true work of repression. Its work is incomplete if this aim is not achieved. Repression doesn't simply aim to forbid certain ideas to be thought. Ideas in themselves are neutral. What motivates repression is the quantum of emotion an idea can awake. It is this emotion that threatens to disrupt the coherence of the subject's idea of herself and to create thus chaos in her conscious life. This is why repression is mainly directed towards such emotions. Once repression is activated, the vicissitudes of the repressed process can be of many sorts, but they can be sorted into three categories. The effect is either successfully repressed or only partially repressed, and in this last case, it can either remain wholly or partly as it is, or be transformed in a qualitatively different effect, often into anxiety. If the effect is successfully repressed, Freud notices that its status is, however, different from that of repressed ideas. Repressed ideas continue to exist as unconscious and have conscious effects, somewhat like in Lipsy's model of the unconscious. Whereas, this is a quote, whereas all that corresponds in the UCS system to unconscious effects is a potential beginning which is prevented from developing. So basically, if repression is successful, all that remains of the effect which was repressed is a sort of disposition to be repeated, to begin again, a potentiality of a new beginning of this same emotion. If repression was entirely successful, then indeed we could say that there are no actual unconscious emotions or feelings. They have no real occurrence in the psyche. Once repressed, they don't stay unconscious, but disappear completely. And the only thing that remains is the possibility that they appear again some other time. Of course, it is a question whether this sort of perfect repression is possible, whether it is a repression can erase or forbid an effect to become conscious in a complete way, in a perfect way. But in any case, if this complete repression is possible, we can know nothing of the repressed emotion. So it doesn't have any sort of psychological existence. Now, there are, however, cases in which repression fails, partially or completely. Now, if it fails completely, the emotion is actually felt. It couldn't be repressed, so it is felt, and it becomes conscious. So, it cannot constitute an example of unconscious emotions either. Now we have a conscious emotion that couldn't be repressed. But when repression succeeds only partially and partially fails, even though the emotion does not become conscious as such, it still has enough force to produce certain conscious effects. It is precisely the main task of psychoanalysts to decrypt these symptoms in order to make them disappear and instead let the emotion come to consciousness in a safe environment and make it so that the subject is able to face it and control it. So, partially repressed emotions continue thus to exist as mental realities without being felt as such. They are either disconnected from their real idea or object, as for instance in the case where anger is directed towards oneself instead of the loved ones, or they appear to consciousness in a disguised form, often as their opposites. For instance, repressed love becomes conscious anxiety or even hate. Thus the emotion in its real form stays unconscious and unknown to the subject, but it does not disappear from his mind. Due to repression, it cannot be actually felt as such, but because of the symptoms it produces, it cannot be ignored either. In this case of unsuccessfully repressed emotions, and only in this case, we can talk of unconscious emotions. The way an unconscious emotion can make itself known to consciousness are very complex, but the results of psychoanalysis show without a doubt that there is sense in speaking of unconscious emotions, provided that we adopt a dynamic point of view of the psychical processes and that we have in mind Freud's definition of the unconscious as the repressed part of our psyche and the idea that repression can sometimes fail. And I have to make a conclusion, a very short conclusion that would just resume the main points of this talk. So, we can conclude that unconscious emotions are indeed possible and an undeniable part of our mental life, but in order to understand them, we need to acknowledge first the existence of an important part of our psyche that stays unconscious. This thesis is dependent on a change of point of view. Only a dynamic psychology like the one defended by Lipsy and Freud can provide a meaningful concept of the unconscious, because unconscious events cannot be seized and described for themselves. Since we only have access to our conscious life, unconscious phenomena can only be inferred from their conscious effects. As we have seen, however, this dynamic psychology of the unconscious that leaps and Freud share, it is not itself compatible with the idea of unconscious emotions. In Lipsy's view, emotions are on the contrary precisely the conscious signs that show us that an unconscious process is taking place. It is only with the next step taken by Freud, when he reinterpreted the unconscious in terms of repression, that the existence of unconscious emotions can be proven. It is only when understood that the unknown cause is related to certain conscious symptoms that unconscious emotions can be finally validated. Paradoxically, they only make sense if the unconscious in question is irreducible and radically different from consciousness, because it is only if deformed by the repression that unconscious emotions can be at the same time present and unknown. Thank you very much for listening.